Hello and welcome to the e-learn on standards and auditing. Today I am Ridhima Dubey. A professional chartered accountant will be taking you through the requirement of standards and auditing SA 250 that deals with the auditor's consideration on laws and regulation in an audit of a financial statement. This is a very important standard because we need to understand that whenever we get engaged by a client or for a particular assignment, there are various laws and regulations that surrounds an entity within which we have to perform our engagement. For example, there could be an industry which is a highly labor incentive intensive industry. In that situation, labor law becomes of primary importance. Similarly, an entity which is engaged in SEZ unit, we need to be considerate of the laws operating around that, without which we'll not be able to discharge our obligation as an auditor. If I talk about the requirement of the standard, as similar to other standards, this standard is also divided into parts. It gives this introduction, which talks about the scope and the effective date. These standards are effective for long now. Then followed by the objective. What is the objective of this standard? We have definitions, then followed with the requirements on what are the auditor's consideration, what kind of procedures we have to perform, how to report on identified or suspected non-compliances, the nature of documentation as an auditor, what we have to keep in our work papers. Then we have this application and other explanatory material, which provides details about these requirements. If I talk about the scope of this particular standard, it deals with the auditor responsibility to consider laws and regulation while performing audit of a financial statements. It does not apply to those assurance engagement where testing and reporting on compliance with laws and regulation is a specific objective. So for that, you have to agree with the management or the engaging party to the nature of compliance that you have to check, the extent of work that you have to perform. So this standard does not deal with it. If you talk about the definition of non-compliance, what do we mean by non-compliance? There is a law, a company does not comply with it. Yes, it is a non-compliance. So if I talk about typically in terms of how standard defines it, it means acts of omission or commission by an entity, either intentional or unintentional. So the standard does not make a distinction whether it is intentional non-compliance, it is unintentional non-compliance. A non-compliance is a non-compliance. It has to be a binary thing, yes or no. Which we talk, definition which the standard gives is, which is contrary to prevailing laws and regulation, and does not include personal misconduct. So if there are employees, for example, a company has an employee which has breached the traffic rules, these standard does not deal with those requirements. So we have to be very clear that the non-compliances are related to those where the entity has not complied with the laws and regulation within which it is required to operate and comply with. What is the management responsibility for compliance with laws and regulation? We as an auditor have to be very clear that before we start examining a particular thing, it is the management responsibility to ensure that those are placed well in record and are being complied with. So management is responsible, and particularly those charged with governance, under which supervision and oversight we are the financial statements are being prepared, that they comply with the policies and procedures which monitor the legal requirement. Those are effectively being operated. There are developed code of conducts. There are proper employee trainings to make them understand the nature of compliances which are applicable to the company, so that even employees are adhering to those required laws and regulation, because entity operates through its employees, directors, employees who are working for the entity. So we have to be clear that they are well aware about the laws and compliances which apply to their entity, so that compliance is ensured in true and spirit. What is the auditor responsibility? If I talk about the auditor itself, SS 200, auditor responsible for obtaining reasonable assurance that financial statement as a whole are free from material misstatement. This particular standard on auditing assist auditor in identifying material misstatement in financial due to non-compliance with laws and regulation. Although I agree that the standard says that material non-compliance with laws and regulation, but we have to be careful that materiality does not apply all the time. There could be certain laws and regulation, for instance, MSME, micro, small, medium enterprise. The law itself talks about dealing with micro, small and medium enterprise. So how can we apply materiality to such laws? The Act has a non-obstantive clause and requires to be adhered in true and spirit. There are serious repercussions where an entity fails to comply with acts like MSME. So you, as an auditor, you have to be very careful that the materiality threshold cannot be fully applied to the concept of laws and regulation. You have to be very judicial in exercising whether laws and regulation actually would like to apply the concept of materiality. Another example, there could be instances that a director got disqualified. You may assume that there is no material non-compliance that may fall on the company, but there are added consequences to it. A director may be holding directorship in other companies as well. The moment he gets disqualified, there are repercussions that other entities would also have to consider whether he still holds valid directorship in those other entities as well. So there are multiple repercussions that gets attached when a particular non-compliance is noted. So we have to be very careful in opting the materiality concept if we want to apply that a non-compliance noted during the course of audit is not likely to have a material impact on the financial statement. Then the standard is very clear that auditor is not responsible for preventing non-compliance. Obviously, we as an auditor are not responsible to ensure that company is not complying with all the laws and regulations. It's their responsibility to comply with it, and we have to examine those compliances. We are not expected to detect non-compliance with respect to all the laws and regulations. As a first step, we as an auditor should discuss with the management, try to understand the laws and regulations structure in which they are operating. This actually helps us to identify to what extent and to what are the applicable law. Because in India, as I speak, there are multiple laws which are operating. And it is very difficult for an auditor to ascertain the 100 number of law that applies to a company. So as a first step, you should always understand the business of the company, try to assess the nature of laws and regulation applicable to them, and then accordingly ensure compliances with examination of compliances with those standards and auditing. There are factors that could attribute that a particular non-compliance is not detected because of inherent limitations of law, inherent limitation of audit. There are certain laws and regulations related to operation which have no impact on financial statement, and accordingly management is not capturing them in their information system. There could be deliberate concealment of compliance, for example, management override of control, a fraudulent activity noted, and whistleblower was raised, but management is not passing on the information to the management. There could be certain non-compliances which are sub judice, where you know that there is a non-compliance, but there is an interpretation issue that is subjected to be settled in the court of law. So if I talk about what is the responsibility with respect to different type of laws and regulation. So the standard says there could be two types of laws and regulations. That one that has direct impact on the material amount disclosed in the financial statement, and second that could have fundamental impact on the operation and going concern. So if I'm talking about laws which are likely to have direct impact on material amount and disclosure in the financial statement, as an auditor, I'm supposed to obtain a sufficient and appropriate audit evidence with regard to its compliance. And where we are talking about fundamental impact on operation and going concern, we have to undertake specified procedures to help identify those non-compliances that might impact the financial statement. However, in the both circumstances, we have to exercise professional judgment. There is no exception to it. We have to be diligent enough while performing our duty and while trying to identify non-compliances related to laws and regulation. If I talk about the auditor's objective with regard to the type of non-compliances, we just noted that in both situations, we have to obtain sufficient appropriate audit evidence to establish the extent of impact that it would have on the financial statement. Then secondly, we have to respond appropriately to those identified which are actual or suspected non-compliances. The manner in which we have to respond will vary depending upon the nature of non-compliance noted. So as an auditor, as you see on your slide, If I talk about auditor consideration for laws and regulation, this is summarized in a form of a flow chart that we have to obtain a general understanding of laws and regulation framework and compliance with that framework, obtain sufficient and appropriate audit procedures for both the types of laws which are impacting the company, whether direct impact or impacting fundamentally the going concern assumption of the company, exercise professional judgment, request management and those charged with governance with regard to written representation. If there is a non-compliance, you have to perform further procedures. If the non-compliance is considered to be resolved, there would not be any impact on the reporting. However, if the non-compliance is not resolved, you have to consider reporting that in your audit report in accordance with the respective reporting standards. We talked about the procedures that auditor needs to perform for identifying any non-compliances with laws and regulations. Let's talk about some of the indications of non-compliance with laws and regulations. Our client had told us that there is an investigation by a regulatory organization and government department. There are search and seizures being performed by income tax department or enforcement director, directorate. There could be serious many such instances which are being highlighted by your client. This indicates that there could be a potential non-compliance. We're not saying that a search and seizure reflect a non-compliance for the client, but it is an indication of a non-compliance. So you as an auditor have to be cautious, exercise your professional skepticism, and understand that there could be potential. These could be a potential indicator that there is a non-compliance. There could be a situation like there are certain transactions where prices are which are transacted at a very high price or a low price. Those provide an indication of fraud or a potential non-compliance with the required regulatory norm where the prices are required to be charged at a particular rate. There could be unusual payment to legal and retainership fee. This could be one of the indicators that there are non-compliances because undue consultant fee is one of the indicators where suppose for a lawyer who is ideally should have paid rupees 1 lakh, but the 10 lakh rupees has been gone, 9 lakh, you don't understand why it is gone. There are no supporting audit evidence which are available for them. So these are typically the indicators where you as an auditor can identify or suspect a reason to believe that there is a likely suspect that there could be a potential non-compliance with laws and regulation. Other example of indicators for non-compliance with laws and regulation could be payment without proper exchange control documentation, unauthorized transaction, improper records, transaction, adverse media comment. These days media is quite active. Every day we are reading in the newspaper that there are certain allegations which are being raised against the managing director of the company, against the director of the company, some employees got involved in some unethical activities. Those kind of media report can also provide you an indication of likely non-compliances for a company. For non-compliances suspected or identified, we as an auditor have to obtain an understanding of the nature, act and circumstances, information, which are required to evaluate the possible impact on the financial statement. Where the suspected non-compliance has been noted by us, the standard requires that we discuss the matter with the management and those charged with governance. Where necessary, we should not hesitate in getting a legal advice. We should probably go and discuss with the legal counsel of the company. We as an independent auditor should also consider obtaining an opinion from our auditor expert. If there is insufficient information on suspected non-compliance, it might impact our audit opinion. So we have to be very careful in settling these procedures. Do not hesitate in obtaining a third-party opinion because we, as a chartered accountant, are also not expected to be knowing all the laws and regulations. So we need to obtain help from the experts. So wherever required, please seek appropriate legal advice and evaluate the nature of non-compliance in respect of auditor's risk assessment and consider whether the written representation if you are seeking in respect of a particular non-compliance which is noted can be relied upon and what are the appropriate course of action that can be taken by you. there could be certain instances where a potential non-compliance is noted by you and the gravity is so high that you may not be likely, you may not be satisfied by issuing a modified opinion. By modified opinion, I mean it could range from qualified adverse or disclaimer of opinion, but you as an auditor, because of the gravity of laws and regulation, you are not able to consider it possible to issue an audit report. The standard provides an option that you might also consider withdrawing from an engagement. In that situation, it is always good to obtain a legal advice, discuss early with those charged with governance, raise your concerns well in time, seek legal advice. We have already talked about. And if required, consider writing it to regulators. For example, an example could be reporting under Section 143(12) of the Companies Act, where an auditor identifies a fraud or suspects a fraud and the management is not providing a appropriate legal action. In that situation, the Companies Act requires auditor to report appropriately to the authorities. Similarly, in the banks, there are requirements for the auditor to report directly to the RBI if there are some fraudulent activities are being identified. So as an auditor, you have to be aware about what are the legal obligations on you as an auditor to report noted non-compliances. And similarly, these should be supported with well-formed work paper why you are reporting, well-formed legal advice if required, and well-formed decision on the extent of, on the nature of audit procedures and the likely and the opinion that you have reached on a particular noted non-compliance. So reporting on, we have already touched a bit about reporting of non-compliance. So as a protocol, first these should be discussed with those charged with governance. We have already talked about an example where reporting on non-compliance is required to be reported to regulators directly. We just talked about example of Section 143(12) under the Companies Act, RBI reporting norms. Similarly, there are other regulators where if the fraudulent activities are noted, you have to report them. Then auditor have to simultaneously consider the impact in their audit report, whether it has to be a modification or they have to, the manner in which they have to be identified, it will vary upon the nature of non-compliance noted and the likely impact on the financial statements. So reporting to those charged with governance, so you have to be clear on the line of authority to whom these suspected or noted non-compliances need to be noted. So it has to be an early communication with those charged with governance so that they also can provide their insight and take appropriate action as may be needed. And we have already talked about seeking appropriate legal advice where the need may be. So this slide in a way summarizes whatever discussion we had so far, that if there are material non-compliances inadequately reflected in the financial statement, you may consider qualifying adverse opinion. There could be other possibility that you may land up giving a disclaimer of opinion as well. For non-compliances where there is a limitation imposed by management or those charged with governance and you are not able to obtain a sufficient appropriate audit evidence, consider modifying by way of qualification or disclaimer of opinion. There could be limitation by circumstances which are even beyond the control of the management. In those situations, you have to exercise your professional judgment and evaluate the impact on the opinion. Reporting to the regulators, we have already talked about it, and it has to be done on need-to-need basis depending upon the regulatory requirements. Documentation, needless to say, is a very critical part of your audit file. And if something is not documented, you cannot prove it. So be sure that it is clearly, appropriately, adequately documented in your work papers, the extent of laws, non-compliance is noted, the procedures performed, and how it has been responded. Thank you very much.